Good morning, Benjamin Seldon, Deputy Principal, Bower Galloboys High School. Just want to talk to you about bubble theory and the way in which we, the strategic, repetitive way in which we teach English at Bower Galloboys that has allowed us to achieve an enormous amount of success with boys in HSC English for a number of years. The process that we use here to teach is called bubble theory, and there's a specific reason for that, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And it utilizes a sentence structure that's very, very simple, and you can see there, it's this, does that, doing that, doing that, which goes on and has variations. For example, doing that, this does that, doing that, and I'll talk about those in a lot more detail in a minute. These videos, historically, they've been too long. I haven't been able to upload them, so I'm going to see if I cut this one in half. First thing you can see there is at least a couple of images that are taken from the Sydney Morning Herald, which demonstrate statistically some of the success that Bally's had. This is possibly around 2014, 2016, one of those years. And you can see that Bally Boys, a comprehensive high school, the only yellow strip there on the left, is equal third in the state in terms of number of students achieving band six per number of students who take that test. The only selective school that's topped us there is James Roos, and it's equal, all the other schools there are non-government private schools. On the right-hand side, you can see the success as well has translated into standard English, and Bower Galloboys is the second yellow stripe there. So the success has been very, very enormous, and it's largely, or it's very much due to this very specific and strategic approach to teaching writing that we use in the school. So let's have a look at the sentence structure here that we use very quickly. So you can see there, it's an exponentially difficult sentence scaffold that we use. It starts off with this does that, which is very, very simple, where this is the technique. As you can see over here on the right, this is the technique. The verb is talking about the effect of that technique, and that obviously being that effect. So much in the same way that a picture tells us 1,000 words, a technique is used in a text type and has an enormous amount of meaning. And so these sentences allow us to extrapolate that meaning with a lot of finesse and sophistication. And it's also a very simple process. So you can see that, so it starts, this does that. For example, it might be the verb suggest he is very strong, and then it becomes increasingly difficult by adding basically ing clauses, and we try to avoid any meta language around this process. It's a simple, I talk about it in terms of s verbs and ing verbs. So you have further on, it's this does that, doing that and doing that, or doing that, this does that, doing that and doing that. Doing that, this does that, doing that, doing that, doing that. So just through a very repetitive process, the boys or the students are able to put together very complex and sophisticated sentences. So I'll come back to this later, but let's have a look at that in action and how it's approached on the board. So when you go into a classroom, what you'll find is that in this case, we're looking at a poem. It's one of Banjo Patterson's poems, Clancy the Overflow, one of the great Australian poems. And in the second half of the poem, he goes on to juxtapose, I suppose, the celebration of the outback with the dark representation of the city. So what you're going to find in the classroom is the teacher is going to identify a particular bit of text that we need to be talking about here. And in this case here, you can see it's been circled. It's got a bubble around it, and that's basically why it's called bubble theory, very complex. So here we have a stingy ray of sunlight struggling feebly down between the houses tall. And the process here is that the teacher works with the students, eliciting a response that deconstructs the ideas in that bit of representation. First part of the scaffold is that we drill the boys in is this sentence or this clause, this the author's use of. So it introduces a noun, it's a nominalization process. And here we have the students identifying the technique, which is obviously a critical part of that process. So here we have personification. So generally what we'll find, personification, is we find that the teacher is going to be putting that, asking that question and putting that sentence on the board. And we get the boys to use that over and 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 over again until they have it down. Obviously there are variations to that, but at the beginning of that process, we adhere to a pretty strict formula. What you'll then find is that the teacher is going to put on the board a variety of verbs that help the students extrapolate meaning there. One of the things that we say very clearly, boys, don't use the words shows, it's awful. A lot of the success that you will have over the years will be dependent on your capacity to draw upon a variety of verbs. And so we start to model that process very early on in year eight. So here we have, for example, evokes, imagines, creates, and suggests, which are some of the verbs that the students will be using again and again and again on their journey through to stage six in the HSC. So the first process that happens in order to encourage the boys to engage in that learning bit, that bit of cognition, is asking the question, okay, what does this evoke? And sometimes we use antithesis. You know, is it evoking the beauty of the countryside? No, it's not. Is it evoking the wonder and the excitement, you know, and the joy of a first date? No, it's not. Is it, you know, along those lines? What's it evoking? It's evoking here the dark and dim misery of the city. So through a process of questioning, we're going to get the students to help put that clause together on the board. And it's really important to use the whiteboard to demonstrate to the boys how to write those words out and create those sentences. One of, I think, the huge assumption, the mistakes made in English teaching is that students learn by listening. They don't. They learn visually, like most of us, and it's really important to see those clauses put together, how they're supposed to be put together. So one of the next examples might be imagines. In this case, we ask the boys, what kind of world is this imagining? Is it imagining a world of campfires and beautiful sunsets? No, it's not. In this part of the poem, it's imagining a world of dark congestion, for example. So, you know, we're going to, through a process of question answer, help the boys or the students in the class can develop that kind of response. We're also suggesting is a very common verb that's used here. What is the implication or what is the suggestion here? Is it a suggestion that city life is fantastic? No, it's not. Clearly, the suggestion is something along the lines that city life is going to be dark and congested and unhealthy. We can also use, for example, you know, you can take as many ideas out as you want. Creates. In this case, what the poet is specifically doing in the second half of the poem here is creating a juxtaposition between the positive representation of the outback that he creates in the first half of the poem. So here we might, again, through a process of questioning, we elicit this, and we get the boys to spell out and work with to create this variety of clauses and responses on the board. Having done that, then we move into the process of actually applying the sentence scaffold. This does that. So I'm going to draw this little video to an end because it's going to get too long, and we'll have a look at how we actually write these ideas down.